I have to be really close. That helps. Okay. All right.
Was it better before?
Okay.
Then let's just get rid of this. I think everyone can tell that I'm not really technologically adept. So I want to quickly go over the symbolism of the Holy Trinity icon, and I would like to address a question that Katharina had, or a comment that Katharina had, before we go on. So welcome back, everybody, to the lectures. First off, the Trinity icon. So many people have attributed different meanings to the various figures of the icon. And typically, usually, and almost always, trademark, is this figure here on the left-hand, our left-hand side of the icon. That is referred to as God the Father. And so God the Father is here on the right, on the left-hand side, on the right of the icon, on the left-hand side, and he is the actual one, the only one who actually blesses. And God the Father's robes are kind of indistinct. They don't have necessarily a distinct color. And he is looking out towards the figures, the other figures, and they are looking towards him. Okay? So they're making eye contact with him. All blessings flow from him. And we also refer to this as the Father because above him is a building. And that building refers to, in my father's house, our name. Okay? The second figure here is typically referred to as Christ. And Christ, because he's typically, usually, almost always represented as blue on the outside and red underneath. And so he has the exact same colors. He is sitting here in the center, and behind him is a tree of the cross. Okay? So that's the next reminder. The third angel would be the angel of the Holy Spirit. And partly this is why we refer to in Russia. We refer to the descent of the Holy Spirit as the green holiday, the Lemnisiyata, because he's green on the outside, he's blue underneath, and there's this indistinct mountain behind him to show the ascent that we go through when we acquire the Holy Spirit. On this table, in a chalice, there is the head of a calf, and so that is the reference to Abraham's hospitality. And so we must still have had a calf. What Andrew Rubioff did was he reduced that incident, the appearance of the three men at the Oak of Mamre, to its essential elements. The original icon, typically, the model that we mostly know is there's usually Abraham and Sarah on either side. And then down here at the bottom is someone killing the fatted calf. But he's reduced it to the essential elements. This square here, painted in reverse perspective, refers to the relic that you would find in an altar table. If you're, is it Robert Rohrer? Is it, no, Richard Rohrer. He had this whole elaborate thing that there used to be a mirror. It's like, oh, how vain. Why would you insert yourself into an icon? And interestingly enough, the opposite of all of that is we talk about inverse perspective in icons. I didn't talk about this in the last lecture. I have notes, but I rarely ever follow them. We talk about inverse perspective in iconography. So everything looks like it's... instead of receding into space, it looks like it's coming forward. So when we look at the gospel book, for example, most of the gospel books, the back comes up and the front is smaller. It isn't perspective in the sense of the Renaissance. disappearing point, the vanishing point of the icon is our heart. And so we complete the icon by viewing it, by participating in it. And as George Corby says, participation in the Orthodox Church is knowledge. And so it isn't until you're fully part of the Orthodox Church that you know all the mysteries. And it isn't until you participate in an icon that you fully understand it. So this is coming towards us in inverse perspective. Why on earth do you need a mirror? You don't want to see yourself reflected in an icon. And the other thing about this icon is, well, there's many other things. They almost form a perfect circle. If you were to draw a circle, they almost form a perfect circle. If you were to draw a triangle, you have an inverse triangle here, and a triangle here. But what for me is the most important is this is the Christ figure, because in the negative space between the two figures, you have a second chalice.
Yes.
And so he's in the center of the chalice. He is the Eucharist. There are some people who, one iconographer in Finland, his name was Petro Seisaki. And Petro Seisaki, he actually painted the head of Christ Emmanuel in the center. And that's occasionally that appears in Proserpine school icons. Why do you need that? When Jesus, if you do it right, Jesus is the center of it all. The Eucharist, the actual communion with God, is the center of everything. So, if you ever paint this icon on your own, future iconographers out there in YouTube land, I will judge you if you don't have the second chalice right. So, anyhow, this is what I love so much about this icon, because it invites us to participate. We participate. It isn't like we're completing the Trinity, but we are completing that icon by experiencing it. And so we can experience every icon by viewing it, by venerating it, by participating. Okay, so that is the explanation. That was, does that cover everything?
Yes.
You're very welcome. I think you can tell I'm talking about icons a lot. The other thing I wanted to talk about, the question from Katarina was, or the statement from Katarina was, so does the Renaissance style of iconography contribute to Catholic? And to say that it's a Catholic icon is a bit of a misnomer, because this iconography that we see, this academic style, is all over the place. And right now, I think it was Professor Richard Schneider who said 90% of the Orthodox world, or the Orthodox in Russia, pray in front of what we would consider non-canonical icons, because they're not painted in the Byzantine style. We're trying to change that. That's why we have all these great iconography schools. But there are so many Renaissance icons. So now, if you could go to the so, I think what I call this lecture is "Who is That Bearded Man?" And so, this was the cover of a book that was printed. It was called "Jesus Christ," and it was an exhibition at the Hermitage or the Russian Museum. I think it was the Hermitage in. It was in St. Petersburg. It was a few years ago, in 2000, where they. The exhibition was called Jesus Christ. And so they gathered up all of their religious paintings, not only icons, but naturalistic paintings, and they put them all on exhibition in an exhibition called Jesus Christ. And so you can scan this image of Christ, this montage of images of Jesus, and even though some of them are woven and look a little bit odd, some of them look very, very naturalistic. One of them, I think it's by Paul Cleve, and you can tell that there's certain things. You respond to this as Jesus Christ. Once I was drawing, I drew a drawing of William Shakespeare in my math class. I was distracted. Anyway, so I drew this, and everyone was going, oh, what a lovely drawing of Jesus. Like, he wasn't bald. Jesus wasn't bald. But anyway. Next. So what we have is somehow this idea of what Jesus is supposed to look like. And I don't know if you remember a few years ago, there was that horrible restoration that happened in Spain, and we got monkey face Jesus. So Jesus was slightly damaged in this one church in Spain, and this very well-meaning woman, 83 years old, who at one time apparently was a good restoration artist, decided to repaint him. And so this is what we have. So I think we can say this is not what Jesus looked like. So we have this innate idea of what Jesus looked like. And partly that's because of iconography. We have to stick to, there are certain, of course there are people who want to paint Jesus in many different guises. I know that there are people who want to paint him as a native American. There are people who want to paint him as an African. There are people that want to paint him as a Chinese person. Great. Jesus is universal. Jesus is every man. But we cannot ignore the historical fact that Jesus was a first century Jew who lived, who was crucified, who moved a certain way, who wore certain clothing. And ironically, we don't represent him in that clothing at all. Okay, next. So there are different types of icons of Christ. There's Christ Emmanuel, so Jesus as a child. Usually when he's Christ Emmanuel, he's represented in golden colors or gold and white. This is from the 16th century, so Christ Emmanuel enthroned. This is from Rush Click. Then we have Christ Almighty, the Pontocrator, and so all you have to do is look up, really. So this is from, Sicily, the Cathedral of Montreal. I don't have all of my notes with me. I grabbed the wrong ones when I came here. And Father Vincent, as good as he was, we didn't get to print out the right thing. So. Anyhow, so this is from Montreal. This is about the 11th century. This represents sort of a culmination of East and West coming together, and this is on the verge of the Renaissance. So there's certain elements that are not exactly Byzantine, but they're still there. Okay, next. So we also have icons of Jesus of the fiery eye. Actually, there's a specific icon that is known as Jesus of the Fiery Eye. And this one is from the 16th century from Russia. Click. This icon is Spas, or this is just Jesus Christ, Pontocrator. You can use Pontocrator for all representations of Jesus. This is an icon done by St. Aru Rubioff, and this is known as Jesus Christ of Zvenigorod. And so this was one of the three icons that were found in that bar in Zvenigorod. According to one story that I've read, I don't know, I've heard many stories about this icon. It's also known as the pickle barrel icon.
Nice.
And it's known as the pickle barrel icon, unfortunately, because they had used the icon to make a pickle box to make real pickles. And the brine of the pickles ate away at the icon. And so I've heard that story, and I've also heard, and maybe these two are both true, equally true. Maybe once they ate the pickles, they used them as steps in a marble. But that's the main story that I heard. But somehow, miraculously, the face of Christ was preserved in all of this. And this icon is from 1425 in Moscow. Next. This is an icon of Christ the Suffering Servant. And this is, I believe it's from Castoria, and that is from the 10th century. And on the opposite side is, if you were to flip it over, there's the Mother of God holding Jesus and the child. Yes, ma'am.
Would these all have been painted in egg?
These are all in egg, yeah. Except for the one that was mosaic. Yeah. Click. And then, so that previous icon was known as Jesus the Suffering Servant. This icon is known as the Mandylion, or the Face Man Without Hands. Technically, this one is actually known as the Karamion, but I'll explain that in a bit. So, and this icon is from the 11th century in Russia. I want to say Novgorod, but I'm not absolutely certain. Click. And then we also have icons of Jesus enthroned in glory. And this is an amazing icon painted by St. Andrei Rublev. It actually is the size of a postcard. I've seen this in person. And it is so incredible and monumental. I've also seen it blown up to cover the side of a two-story building. And it still holds up. Like, there's nothing. And so here he is. Jesus is enthroned in glory on the angelic throne. So when he's in glory, he's in gold. Or usually gold, or he can also be in white. You can see his throne is sort of mystical and in the back. And then he's surrounded by seraphim. And then you can also see the symbols of the four evangelists. That's exactly what we have back there on the dais in the church. And then we have this icon of the Pantocrator. This was painted by Metropolitan Jovan from Serbia. And so we know this because he signed it. And so we have this idea that iconography is typically, usually, almost always, a trademark, anonymous. But how many people have been named so far? You know, so lots of times the theory is we leave the name away so that the glory goes to God. But St. Andrew Rublev is this. Saint Daniel Chorny, Daniel the Black, his companion. We know the work that he did. And for myself, mostly, if you look at my icons, you can tell that I did. Everybody kind of has their own style. But if you look here, you can see very distinctly that there are two garments. There is the inner garment, which is known as the chiton, C-H-I-T-O-N. All of my students are starting to be a quiz. The chiton, and then on the outside there is what's known as the chimation. And essentially it is an undergarment with the toga. And there is what's known as a clavus. So singular is clavus, plural is clavi, or it's a clavium and clavia. And that was a symbol of that you were of senatorial rank. They were always two. Click. So you can see here the clavi going up and down the garment. They went from the collarbones, which is clavicles, down all the way. So here it is. So this is one of the earliest representations in a panel icon of the crucifix. can see that element of the two garments always being present. So there's the inner garment and the outer garment, and there's also a clavus there. And that is an icon from Skof in the 17th century. Again, the people who really like architecture. But then, as Heiko Schlaper used to speak about icons, he would speak about Jesus's work clothes and his Sunday go meeting clothes. So his work clothes were always blue on the outside and red underneath, and his transfiguration clothes, or his glorification clothes, were either white. And you can't get away, honestly, I have heard people make other arguments that Jesus' robe should be different colors than this in the transfiguration. And they should be white, because what does it say in scripture? In St. Mark's Gospel, I love St. Mark's Gospel because he's very, very down to earth. He says, Jesus' robes shone brighter than any, a brighter white than any fuller on earth was able to make them. But what's a fuller? A fuller is a washer. It's like taking your clothes to get as white as possible to the dry cleaner. So no fuller on earth could make them whiter than that. So they have to be white in the transfiguration. No, they have to be white. And so this is the transfiguration icon from 14th century Novgorod. Click. And so you can see how Jesus' Sunday go meeting clothes vary. This is an icon that I'm very familiar with. This is painted by Archimandrite Zenon in about 1990. He decorated the trapeza of Valamo Monastery. So I got to see this every day when I was eating there. Click. So notice this hand. You notice his hands in a couple of different positions. This hand here is technically not a blessing. This hand is actually a teaching hand. So there's different meanings to the hands. And if you click, okay, go back one. So notice that there's two fingers up and three fingers down. So kind of like this. This was a symbol showing that if you were looking at sculpture from ancient Greece, if you saw the sculpture of Socrates teaching, he had two fingers up and three fingers down. It's a symbol that I have something to teach you. That was also the way that you got the attention of the emperor when you were in court in Byzantine times. You held up your hand, two fingers up, three fingers down. And he would call them. Okay? If you go to the next slide. Sorry. No, it's okay. I'm not paying you, so it's okay. You have the typical blessing hand. So you have the pinky finger up, the ring finger, and the thumb touching. You have the middle finger slightly down and making an X with the index finger, and then the index finger makes another sort of C shape. So Jesus is blessing with his name, just like I bless you with Jesus' name every time I bless you. I see X. So that's the initials. So every time we bless, that's what you get. Now, when you're blessing yourself, of course, you're crossing yourself with three fingers and two fingers. This is where things get complicated because there is that old believer schism that happened. And so they called upon the icons in their defense. So there's two fingers up and three fingers down. For them, the two fingers represented the up. We cross ourselves with the two fingers and the three fingers. So we're crossing ourselves with Jesus, and then we're also reminded of the Holy Trinity. But in the Nikonian reforms, he said, no, what they're doing in Greece at this time is they're crossing themselves with three fingers and two fingers. It got to the point where I know of this man who only would cross himself with a fist, because he just didn't want to offend anybody. So, anyhow, so this is the blessing hand, or the teaching hand from the Sinai Pantocrator. Click. And so you can see here. So Jesus is going in this, as he is Christ Emmanuel in Mary's breast. He's got his two fingers up and his three fingers in, going, I have something to teach you. And then he will unveil his scroll. So typically, usually, and almost always, when you see Jesus, even if he's a baby, he's holding a scroll. Always referring to him as the Word of God. There's always something. If he's riding a donkey, he's holding a scroll. If he's at the wedding at Cana, he's holding a scroll. Frequently, it just looks like this white cigar, but yes. Yes, he is holding a scroll, a codex, representing his teaching that he is the Word of God. And then we also have, typically, usually, almost always, in Jesus' halo, there's writing. Now, if you were Slavic, you read from the top, down, left, right. Okay? So you have ho, there's actually a mistake here, there should be a referent. So ho, om. So I, essentially, is I am. If you're Greek, you read from Jesus' right side around. So ho, om. The only thing that I say to all of my students is to make sure that the nu is on our right side of the icon, because otherwise what it says is oh no, and you don't want to do that. And then here you have Jesus Christos. So we have the beginning letter of his name and the end letter of his name in Greek, and then the squiggly bit over top, which in the Slavic land can be like that, but in Greek they have slightly different markings. And that shows there's a bunch of letters missing and then there's an accent. Same thing here, Jesus Christos. And so typically, usually, and almost always, you don't translate that from the Greek. But we have on our iconostasis here, we have I am. We typically don't translate Jesus Christ, but there are people who do. It's just tradition that you would keep it in the original Greek. Click. Again, that's why I recommend it, Zenon. And so this is what we saw every day in our trapeza. So this, it looks like this is an altar, and this is an altar to essentially the Mother of God. So there was a specific bread. So if you, when we do proskomedia, so that service where we're cutting up the bread for the sacrifice that happens in the liturgy, there's one section that is dedicated to the Theotokos. And so we would set that aside on Sundays and feast days, and we would leave that to the end of the liturgy, and we would process behind it to our trapeza. And then after the service, we would have a memorial service for the Mother of God, where we divided that up, because apparently she appeared to the apostles after her dormition and explained how to do this. And so we do this, it's done in monasteries all the time. And so we cut it up and we give it to everybody who's present. And so it's a very nice tradition to have. Notice also that the architecture in icons doesn't make a lot of sense. Maybe it's because there's no gravity, I'm not sure. But anyway, so yeah, kind of floating. But this is some of the marvelous iconography in the Lamo Monastery. Notice that the Virgin Mary's robes, and I was going to talk about that, but our time is rapidly running out. Her robes are blue on blue, but typically, usually, and almost always, they're the opposite of Jesus' robes. Now, why do we have a Virgin Mary here? Click. Oh, that's not okay. Oh, yes. And so we have Christ Emmanuel here being held aloft by the archangels Michael and Gabriel. See, again. Sometimes you'll see Jesus' halo and there isn't anything written. Sometimes there's just symbols, there are jewels painted. Click. Christ Emmanuel again. This is from the 18th century in Russia. Click. And here he is, Christ Emmanuel, still. As Emmanuel, he's dressed in gold, he's glorified. And you can see the sign there, so we've got a lot of repetition. This is from a baptismal chapel in the Troitsa Sergei Vlava. So this was all decorated in fresco. Unfortunately, what happened because it's so humid in there, the fresco never actually dried, and so so it's been rotting. They've been trying to figure out how to restore it. Click. And so here Jesus is again enthroned in glory. This is from Ravenna in the 8th century. And here he is flanked by angels. And the people who sponsored the baptistry, or the sponsored the church. Click. Now, you can see here, Jesus' undergarment being purplish-red with the clavos all the way up. And here he is, this is Ecce Homo, Behold the Man. And this was painted by Theophan the Cretan, and this is, the 15th century in Mount Athos. Click. And we also have the Man of Sorrows, so that's known as extreme humility, or sometimes it's also known as the bridegroom. And so this would be the icon for the Bride of the Magdalens during Holy Week. This was painted, this is a modern icon, painted in the 1980s by the nuns of New Monastery in New York. Click. And so again, Man of Sorrows. One of the things that we try not to do is have a lot of emotion in the icons. And one of the sad things about our foray into academic style is they became extremely emotional, trying to evoke emotions from us and sorrow and things. So yes, he's a man of sorrow, but he doesn't have to look that bad. Click. And on that same vein for us, we have the Do Not Lament the icon. This is from the 16th century in northern Russia. And this is the icon that you typically, usually and almost always have if you didn't have a plushie. So the plushie is the icon of Jesus being brought out into the center of the church on Great Holy Friday. So we venerate him in the tomb. But if you didn't have that, you have this icon. So essentially it's the iconographic version of the Pietà. And normally what you'd have is you'd have the whole troparium around Do Not Lament Me, O Mother, singing the end of the tomb. And that could be used as a plushie. Next. But that's okay. This is an actual plushie. It's painted on a panel. There's more to it, but can you just shift it a little bit? Yeah, just scoot it. So you can see Jesus laying in the tomb, surrounded by the symbols of the four evangelists, and it's a modern icon, painted in St. Petersburg within the last 100 years. Click. But the Plaza Niza has very much a connection with the Shroud of Turin. And so Jesus lying in the tomb, you have the Shroud of Turin where it shows Jesus lying in the tomb. There's some people, I'm not going to condemn on either side whether or not the Shroud of Turin is actual, whether or not it's a forgery or not, whether it is really the burial shroud of Christ. But there's a distinct similarity. I mean, how Jesus is lying on the Shroud of Turin is so much like the Plaza Niza itself. If it were painted, what an amazing painting. If it is truly that, well, then what an amazing relic that we have. But shrouds were a popular commodity at one time. But according to many scholars, the Shroud of Turin was located in Constantinople when the icon of Christ was being developed. When the idea of Christ, how he should be represented, was being solidified. Click. So you can see here that image that we normally associate with the Shroud of Turin. Click. So here we see the Mandylion, so the face made without hands icon, being held aloft by angels, and down here, the direct connection with Jesus' suffering. And so Jesus, the Pietà, essentially, Jesus down from the cross in the tomb. This is about the 16th century in Russia. Click. And here we have a representation of the Holy Mandylion This is a modern icon. It is found in Finland at a monastery in a place called I want to say it's Papiniemi. There's a fellow who was a restaurateur. His name was Hilarion, and he wanted his own monastery. He wanted to be a monk. He was desperate to be a monk. And he couldn't enter the Lama monastery for various reasons. And so he bought it himself, an old barn and an old piece of land. And he was finished, but he was adopted by a Russian, not hierarchy, but Russian diplomats. And he became a cook and cooked for Americans in Russia. And he had an amazing restaurant. Anyways, long story short, he made his own monastery. Now he's an ikemen, head of his own monastery. And this is from the iconostasis in his monastery. So you can see the face made without hands again, held aloft by holy angels. And then you can see the different variations of the story of how it came about. So for us Orthodox, sorry, for us, if we were Catholic, and I don't know why I have a double image, they refer to the icon of Veronica. And so if, I believe it is the sixth station of the cross, maybe the fourth station, one of those early stations where Jesus falls, and Veronica wipes his face with her handkerchief. And so when she wipes her face, Jesus' face with her handkerchief, the image of his face comes off on the cloth. And so that's known as the Veronica icon. We don't know if Saint Veronica actually existed, because her name means true icon, Vera Icona. So that's an explanation for how we got this image. Click. But for us Orthodox, we have the story of King Abgar. King Abgar is up here. And King Abgar, he was a leper from Syria. And he heard about Jesus and all of the things that he was doing in Jerusalem. And you know, he somehow believed that if only he could see the face of Christ, he would be healed. And so he sent his court painter to go and paint this image of Christ as he was going about Jerusalem. Well, I mean, he's the Lord, he's busy, he's raising the dead, he's feeding the 5,000. Who has time to sit down? And so the court painter is doing his very best to paint this portrait, and Jesus, being omniscient, knows his predicament. And so he comes over and he takes the cloth and he's wiping his brushes on and wipes his face with it. And upon that cloth was the face of the hands. Okay? Click. And so you can see here the court painter presenting the image to King Abgar. Okay? Click. And so we get this image of the Mandelion, the face made without hands. Sometimes it's known as, sometimes you see it and he's got his beard all kind of pulled together. It's known as the Mandelion of Jesus with the wet beard. Literally, that's what it's known as. Click. And so you'll see this. This is like 16th century Russia. Click. And again, a Mandelion, very simply done. It's about the same, about the 14th century. Click. And again, this one, when you see it in the flesh, it makes you go weak in the knees. This is just such an incredible image. And this is in the Tretyakov Gallery in Moscow. This is from the 13th, early 14th century. And you can see, if you look very closely, it's on a piece of cloth. It's a painted piece of cloth. The cloth is in the background on the icon. Click. Again, Jesus with the pointy beard. Click. And this one was done by Petro Seisaki, so the iconographer in Finland. And so you can see a whole Mandelion. This is on the back of the icon of the Mother of God Queen, so click. And this is another one of the icons that we have in Valama Monastery of the Holy Mandilion. But you can see as things have been changing, the influence of the academic schools. Like, and again, Monkey Diakoni Dosafe's icon. Now this image has been, well, I suppose you couldn't actually say it's an icon because it doesn't have the writing. But I know many people would respond to this image far more than any other image of the face made with hands. Click. So what is hypothesized is the image, the icon of, let's try that again, the Shroud of Turin had been folded up in such a way that the face was on top. And so all of this cloth was folded up, the face is on top, and that's what was in Constantinople when this icon was being developed. Okay? Click. But there is an interesting thing. There's a second category of icon, which is known as the Kerameon icon. And so what happened was after King Abgar had this absolutely amazing relic that came directly from the hands of Christ, because of iconoclasm, an early event of iconoclasm, the icon was taken and put away in a wall. And this wall had a vault that was made with ceramic tile. They put it in this vault, closed it up, and when this period of iconoclasm left, they remembered, oh, we haven't got this miracle working icon. And so they went into the vault, pulled it out, and the face made with their hands had been touching one of the ceramic tiles. And so it imprinted on the tile. And so if you see an icon of the face made with other hands without a cloth, that's known as the Kerameon, the ceramic icon. And so you can tell the difference because Jesus' eyes are looking that way. And on the other ones, he's looking to the other way. I put him just looking straight on the top up there. But that's where that icon comes from. Click. And so you can see how different our representation of Jesus is than very naturalistic. I mean, that's that if you take the Shroud of Turin, like it's very popular, you can move it and you can see Jesus' face, and then it's just Shroud of Jesus' face. Well, you can see how different our representation is. Okay. And then finally, we have the image of the icon made without hands that was above the Chalky Gate, which was taken down and destroyed during the iconoclasm. And so these were the three icons that were down at the bottom of that icon of the face made without hands in Finland. Click. And then we probably have one of the most famous representations of Jesus. The icon of Christ from Sinai. And many people speak about this icon as having two natures, showing the dual nature of Christ. Also, I mean, there's for the longest time, I couldn't find a proper analysis of it, a historical analysis of this icon. And most recently, there was a book by Father Maximus Kostas, I believe is his name. He has this wonderful analysis of this whole icon, bringing up historic documents. And he shows that there's something, what's very special about this icon is Jesus is actually coming towards us again. Because looking at this, at the background, there's a bit of architecture. It's like he's just stepped out from a house. He's stepping towards us. He's coming towards us. And he's wanting to teach us. He's wanting to interact with us. But, as I said, what most people make of this icon is that there's a dual nature. Click. So this side is the human side. This is the very kind, compassionate side. This is the side that, you know, when you're feeling low, so when you put the two together using our wonderful technology, we have a very naturalistic portrait of someone who looks like Jesus. This is somebody that you could see by indulging in the 7-Eleven plate. But then we have God, this very strong, dramatic, hieratic pose of a very frightening image, a very frightening visage. But when you put them both together, click, then you have this very interesting harmony. Now, it's still, while I do like what Father Maxwell says in his book, The Art of Seeing, I still think it's a little bit hard to say distinctly that that is absolutely what it's supposed to be. And I have my own theory of what it is. Click. I believe that it was a teacher and a student who painted the icon together. So if we go back home, I just want to explain one thing. So this was painted in Picasso. So think about trying to paint an image, paint a painting with molten wax. Wax is melting, the wax is melted and it's hardening as you're trying to paint it. So that is your binder for your page, so trying to put it all together. And so you have the instructor, you have the master painting this side, and then he goes, okay, now this is your half. So now let's go to the next one. This is what happened with this icon. So my instructor at the time, his name was, he's now a Metropolitan Arsenic. And he looked at my icons and he said, I think you're painting, I'm not going to do my impersonation again because this is YouTube. I think you paint your icons with too many colors. I'm going to show you how to paint an icon with only 5 colors. And this is a 5-color icon. There is cobalt blue, yellow ochre, cadmium red light, and black and white, and that's it. And he painted this half of the face. And then he said, I want you to paint the rest of the face and the rest of the eye. And so I did my very best to match what he painted, but I did miss. You can tell that there's a distinction between them. Anyhow. I did want to speak very quickly, since I have this this icon up, and it's so very, very clear. I wanted to speak about Jesus' robes. When I was when I first came alive in Orthodoxy, I was taught, and you're going to read it differently in different books. There are different iconographers who have different meanings for this, but I was taught this at St. Hermes. I saw this by my priest. That Jesus is red underneath and blue on the outside because red symbolizes divinity. Red symbolizes the blood of the sacrifice. Red symbolizes the great high priest. And blue symbolizes humanity. So he is God, and by becoming incarnate, he wraps himself in humanity. That's how it was explained to me. Now you're going to find other books that are going to see other things. And I've heard that the great high priest would wear red robes when he went to make the sacrifice. This makes perfect sense. There are other people who are going to say different things. Red is the color of the earth and blue is the color of heaven. But it doesn't make sense if you take that same theory and apply that to the day colors. Because she's typically, usually, and almost always, blue underneath and red on the outside. She's blue because she's human, and she wraps herself in divinity by giving birth to Christ. So what do you do with blue on blue? Well, that blows your whole theory. There's one iconography book where, I'm not going to mention any names since this is YouTube, but it says that in this icon, the colors represent this because. But in this icon, the colors represent this because it's like, is there no consistency? That's something else that we can talk about. But anyways, that's how I remember that. I was really, really fancy when I was doing the writing. But yes, so this is was one of the first icons I painted when I was in jail. And so we have also Jesus with a ceased here. You can see this, the glory of his incarnation, of his divinity shining through. That's what most people refer to that as when you're seeing this gold line, this beautiful gold line that is on him. Again, this is the mosaic that is from Constantinople. Click. And then this is a dome that was painted by Theophon the Cretan for in Mount Athos, and I believe it's Metaora, but I'm not sure. Click. And then again, we have this Coptic icon. And notice how they have changed the colors. So he's white underneath and red on the inside. So white symbolizing divinity and red symbolizing. See, again. And Jesus has one finger up and three fingers down, showing that there's one God and three persons. So, click. And as I said, this is, sorry, I didn't say anything about this. This is from Rostov. This is basically what the Christ's Vengador would have looked like whole. Click. And again, Christ Pontocrator. This is from Simon Ushakov. So that's the 16th or 17th century. Click. And then we get icons, which are folk icons. So people were needing icons, and people did their best. So this is a four-color icon. And this is from Christos Kakivaltios, so Christ the Almighty, and it's from the 17th century in Northern Russia. Click. And this is by Yuri Gashev. So this is about 2000. Click. And again, another attempt at reconstructing what Christ's Vengador would have looked like, completed. This is again a modern Russian icon. Click. And this is Christ of the Last Judgment, where his hair will be like gold. I've never painted this one, but this is modern Russian iconography. So you can see the writing all the way around. And notice how his halo isn't really there. The cross that is in his halo extends. Jesus is the only person represented with a cross in his halo. He's the only person who should be represented with a cross in his halo. And notice that there is no writing, which is the appearance. Click. This was an icon done by one of my instructors. His name is Slava Mikhailenko. So, Christ is the fighting guy. Click. This is the actual Christ of the Fighting Guy.
Can see why?
Yes. And so this is, I think it's 14th century, it might be earlier, 14th century Russia. And I've seen this in the flesh. And it just, yeah, you understand exactly why it's the Fighting Guy. But that name is lent to the whole category of icons that are essentially a bust of Jesus. Click. And again, Christ is but there's something so incredibly compassionate about this face that you just get lost in the incredible beings. Click. So as I said, Jesus has his work clothes, and so you have the feasts of or the events of his healings. These are from the cycle in the church for the Sundays of after Easter. So Jesus healing the blind man. Jesus healing the paralytic, take up your mat and walk. Jesus healing or raising Lazarus, click. These were all done by Theophon of Crete. Jesus with the woman at the well. You know, again, his work clothes, they're really kept clean anyways. Click.
Her garments were red and blue.
Yes. Go back. So, has she become like Christ by hearing his message?
I guess so, yeah.
See, how interpret that? It, like, you see, there can you say one of the only saints, one of the only evangelists, sorry, one of the only apostles that is represented with the same coloration as Jesus is Saint Mark. I edited a book for a friend of mine, Todor Mitrovic, and the book is basically the function of color blue in icons. And the whole book is about the color blue. And he has this whole chapter on why Saint Mark himself is the only apostle that can be represented with the same colors as Jesus. Fotini ends up becoming an evangelist. She's considered equal to the apostles. So could that change that she repents have caused this color change in her garments?
One more question?
Sure, one more answer.
She has her hair out.
Yep.
Seeing with women?
What's my phrase?
Almost always.
Typically, almost always. Yes. So it shows that she is not bound by the same traditions and the same laws because she's a Samaritan woman. And so she's outside of the norm. She's outside of the societal norms that are foisted upon the people of Jerusalem because she's not part of the Hebrew nation. So, yeah. Very good. Great observations. Click. And so here we have the Transfiguration, again, those amazing rays coming out from Jesus. This is a micro-mosaic. This is located in the Louvre. I went to the Louvre to see this icon, and it was lent out for some exhibition. But anyways, it's quite small, but it's absolutely amazing. And so you can see Jesus and his glory shining forth. And he's surrounded by what's known as a mandorla. A mandorla is a device that is used in iconography to show that what you are seeing you have to have spiritual eyes to see. So if anybody else were on Mount Tabor at the time, they wouldn't be able to see Jesus' transfiguration. So anytime you see that device, that's what's happening. So you wouldn't click. So again, in this icon by Saint Theophan the Greek, you can see his glory coming out. You have not only the mandorla, but you also have this other shape of his glory. And then you also have these rays coming down to each of the apostles, showing that his glory was revealed to them as far as they could bear it. So St. Peter's chatting with Jesus, going, hey, it's good that they hear about this little booths. And John is contemplating it. Actually, there's the one that we have a copy of it in the Lama Monastery, and it looks like John is actually getting sick. And then you have James, and he's like, oh, I can't even bear to look. But his glory was revealed to them as far as they could bear. And what I love about this is this detail here. You see Jesus going up with the apostles, talking about what's going to happen, and then he's debriefing them, talking about what happened and how this message is supposed to go out into all the world. Click. And again, another transfiguration. This one, interestingly enough, I made a comment to an iconographer friend of mine on Facebook saying, why do you have a red mandorla? It's like, no, they should always be blue. And it's like, example A. And so this is from the same group that the raising of Lazarus was from that I showed in the previous lecture. Click. And Jesus resurrecting the dead. So this is from Novgorod. You can see, it's from the 16th century, and so you can see here is this wonderful white figure of Jesus shining forth. You see this mandorla of his glory showing that you need the spiritual eyes to be able to see. You have all of the kings and even John the Baptist who had gone, still doing his job as forerunner. Here's Adam, here's Eve, here is Moses, and a bunch of men died. And then here we have Jesus trampling the gates of death with all the this is an icon again of the resurrection, but Jesus, I think this is from Serbia, but Jesus is now in golden colors. And you can see the tombs are completely open, and people have come out of them. Click. And again, Jesus at his mother's death. So there he is in gold. He's already in glory. He can also be in white, but it's to keep him separate from this little figure here of Mary's soul. So again, if you were just a bystander, you wouldn't be able to see this. But since the apostles were there, and frequently there's also women coming down from the buildings mourning, and then the first two bishops, so James of Jerusalem and I think Dionysius are there, and Peter with the center. Click. Again, there are no women. Again, you can see this so clearly, and Mary was a little bit put out. Her soul was a little bit put out. Well, it was, but anyways, go on. Click. So Jesus is enthroned in glory. So he can be enthroned in glory in his working clothes, and then you emphasize his divinity by using the gold. This is a modern Russian icon from St. Petersburg. Click. And when he ascends in glory in Amandorla, that's usually on the Feast of Ascension. And so that's where we get this whole idea of him being enthroned in glory. There he is sitting on a rainbow in this Amandorla ascending to heaven. So the next image, like, here he is in his work clothes again, but there's a Amandorla behind him showing him glorified. And that's from the 14th century in Novgorod, I believe. And this is a modern interpretation of Jesus in glory by Archimandrite Zenon. So I mentioned Zenon from time to time. Archimandrite Zenon is one of the people credited with the revival of traditional iconography in Russia. And when we had a library, one of the books that I had donated to the library was about his work and how his work influenced several other iconographers. And so Zenon is absolutely an amazing iconographer and still extremely influential today on modern iconography in Russia. Click. Again, the image painted by Andrei Rublev of Christ on the throne. Again, the golden glory that we see. Click. And this is painted by Leonid Uspensky. So he was credited with reviving iconography in the West, and his students painted the baptism of Christ over here and the Saint Magdalene over there. Click. And then Jesus can also be represented as a great high priest. And so here he is represented as a bishop. And we see him there represented as a bishop as well. This one was done by, I want to say Angelos, from Greece in the 16th century. Click. And then finally we have Christ as the great high priest, serving as a great high priest in this icon of the Eucharist. And if you want to see something very, very similar to this, go to Holy Trinity here in the city, because I painted that for the National. So, but there he is as the great high priest, serving as the great high priest. And so I was having a debate with myself how to represent him here. Should he be represented as the great high priest with priestly robes, or should he be in his Sunday, in his work clothes? Whether, it's a moot point now, it's done. So, but this is from about 1980 or 1990 by Petros Exarchi. Click. And then, of course, there's the friendship icon. And so you have to wonder what color Jesus' robes were originally. Or were they just not as catacomb painting, where here he is, he's almost the youngest of everybody. But why is he connected that way? It's interesting as well, at that very time when that image was painted, Jesus is also represented by loads of fishes. So we have that notion of ichthyos again, that Jesus Christ, Son of God, Savior, no, I think that's what ichthyos translates into. But also elsewhere in the catacombs, we finally see an image of Jesus with a beard. And Jesus doesn't normally have a beard for several centuries. But in the beginning, in Ravenna, in this mausoleum of Gallia, he's represented as a good shepherd. He's represented kind of like Dionysius or Apollo. So beardless, wavy hair. You'd be very hard-pressed to call him Jesus, but because he's holding a cross, we connect him distinctly with Jesus. Frequently, I get asked, there's an icon of Jesus, the good shepherd, where he's packing the sheep on his shoulders. But there is a canon that says we're not allowed to represent Jesus as a sheep, but there's no canon that says we're not allowed to represent him as a shepherd. And so him holding the sheep around his shoulders is not him holding himself, he's holding the lost sheep. And these sheep here, is it his biblical flock, or is it a reference to what happened later? There was a representation of Jesus as a cross, and all of the apostles were represented as lambs. I think that's also in the clip. But then you also have Jesus, the warrior, trampling down the lion and the adder, click. And Archimedes Zenon, he actually did a modern version of that. So the lion and the adder don't look dead, they look stupid. You know, the lion looks a little bit like sugar when she's been dead. But notice, he's still looking like a young man, young Apollo, very much the earliest representations. Click. And so you can even see Jesus here riding in on the ass. So here's Jesus. He's entering into Jerusalem, and that is apparently St. Peter behind him. And this is from an ossuary, a bone box, that had been carved. And so look at how young Jesus is. But remember how I said he was typically represented holding a scroll no matter what he was doing. Well, that's what he has in his hand. That was from about the 4th century. Click. And Jesus is such a young man. I mean, I don't think he even shaves yet. But there is a detail. Click. And Jesus, when he's before Pilate, he looks very feminine. All of this is recounted for us in Thomas F. Matthew's book, The Clash of Gods. And I highly recommend if you want to read a very interesting book that traces this evolution, it is excellent. Click.
It's weird that his face looks so feminine, but if you look at his hand, it's a very masculine.
Exactly. Yeah. But still, we're trying to figure out who Jesus really is. Son of man, is he, where does he fit in all of this? Click. And so we get this really weird image of Jesus this is the Arian baptistry. And so Jesus is being baptized, that's the old hairy guy, that's a personification of the River Jordan. You have John the Baptist baptizing him, and if you didn't see this, you'd swear this was a woman being baptized. That's Jesus. See? And so there was a certain androgyneity to Jesus early on in his iconography, and yet, click, this weird Apollo-istic representation of Jesus is something that Michelangelo harkened back to when he was representing Jesus in the Last Judgment. Click. So you can see this androgynistic face. Click. But where Jesus gets his beard is where things clash in the sense of Jesus had to take over the role of head of the gods in the Roman Empire for him to have credibility. And so if you were a Roman god, what did you look like? You had a full beard, you're wearing a toga. This is the god Asclepius, the healer god, the god of medicine. And so the only thing that's different about this image is the fact that he's holding a stick and he's only wearing one garment. But as time goes on, we also see this is a representation of Zeus. Click. Wavy hair, beard. That was actually the garment and the representation of a philosopher. And so that connection, not only between the authority of the Greek gods, the head of the gods, Zeus and Asclepius, but also the representation of a philosopher. This is not, as I said, Jewish clothing from the first century. This is Greek garments. And so you can see the influence. And you can also see the influence of the paintings of about the same time of the god Serapis, when you compare him to Click, the representation of Christ Sinai. Okay? So there's that spin that comes up. So we've got this androgynous Christ, we have this young effeminate Christ, we also have a bearded Christ. And where this all comes together, Click, is in this representation. Well, finally, we have this representation of Jesus being the Most High God amongst the apostles, and this is in the mausoleum of. Well, it's probably been printed all the abscess of. It's a church. It's a church in Rome. But you can see also, so this is original iconography. And then all the other faces, you can see that they have changed. So whether or not this was Jesus absolutely, or this was Zeus in the Council of the Gods, there has been some changes. But there's a cross up above his head, which says, this is the Christ. Click. Where this all comes to a head is we have these three representations of Jesus, three representations of Jesus all at the same time. Jesus wasn't allowed to be represented as a lamb, as I said, in that one council. But in the beginning, click. Oh, sorry, go back one. I thought I had the image. So if you look up here, if you can zoom in. It's so handy we have it in here. There you go. So here is an image of the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world, upheld by the four angels. Up above that, you have Christ, the bearded one, Christ looking like he's in the council of the gods. And if you stand up a bit, then just push up. Scan down. Is that okay? And then here you have Jesus, Emmanuel, Christ Emmanuel, enthroned in the world. Click. So we saw that image before of Christ Emmanuel on the world, and that's in the apse of that church. Then the next image is in the dome. Click. Jesus the Lamb, which was condemned eventually, and then. The next image, Jesus the Almighty. Jesus being represented as a lamb was condemned because he became a parent. And so that's why we can't represent him as a lamb. We shouldn't represent him as a lamb. These rules are not universal. They're universal for the Orthodox Church, but if you look in any Catholic Church, you can find Jesus as a lamb everywhere.
Click. So what does this say about our image of Jesus? This was painted by, I'm trying to remember what his name was, but this is very much an illustration from a book, from a children's book. So if we believe in Jesus, Jesus is universal, and if we believe in Jesus, he's universal, we can ride on an elephant, we get to eat grapes, we even get a bicycle, but yet he is everywhere, and he is a God for all nations. That representation is very close to what we feel Jesus would have looked like. Very much different than the blue-eyed Jesus that we typically see in Protestant churches, or the emotional statuary that we see in Spanish countries. This image of Christ here is an averaged image. What happened was a forensic scientist took, a few years ago, they dug up all of these skeletons of men from the time of Jesus that were in a Jewish cemetery, and they did forensic reconstruction, and then they averaged it. And so, because Jesus was a man of a reputation, they believe that this is what Jesus probably looked like. So about 5'4", kind of nondescript. I prefer to believe that Jesus looked a little bit like something else. Click. And so this is where we come to the end of our journey. Whether or not Jesus looks like our iconographic representation of him, or he looks like the actual representation of what he would have been like in the first century AD is irrelevant, because it's the Jesus of faith that we believe in. I find it always so disheartening when there are these documents, the documentaries that come out of the various seasons, like Christmas or Easter, you know, finding the historical Jesus or, what actually happened in Bethlehem or how, whatever. You can talk about all of these things, but really my faith does not waver when I see any other representation of Jesus. For example, does it matter to me at all if the Shroud of Turin is true or not? No. Does it matter to me at all that Jesus maybe didn't dress like a third century prophet? Does it matter whether or not he had blue eyes or not? Chances are he probably did. What matters to me is how I encounter him in my prayer, how I encounter him through the icon. There was a show many, 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 many years ago that you probably remember, Don, and it was called St. Elsewhere. And there was this one episode where one of the characters, played by Howie Mandel, he went, in the first episode he went to hell, and the second episode he went to heaven, and he was very, very excited about meeting God. And when he met God, he met himself. God had his face, because we are made in the image and likeness of God. And I think that's a very interesting way to view it. I'm sure when we see God, when we encounter God in reality, we will immediately recognize him. And it will be far beyond anything that we represent here. And yet, he will be so familiar and so intimate to us that it will all make sense. So, this is all I have to say about the icons of Christ. I hope I didn't scandalize anybody by saying that he didn't always look like we believe he did. But historically, we can see the evolution of his image. I saw it, and all I could think of is like, you painted him in white.
Or in like hippie Jesuses.
Right. Yeah. There's an amazing church in Finland that was decorated by a man. He was a very famous artist at the time, and he was commissioned to decorate this church. And he said, "I'll do it on two conditions. One, no one can say anything about
three icons known that have been painted by St. Luke. This is one of them. There's another book that says St. Luke painted 72 icons of the Theotokos, 36 with Mary holding the Christ child, and 36 without. And they were all painted on wood from the table of the Last Supper. Now, either they were all really small icons, or that was one honking big thing. But anyhow, so we have this icon that was given as a wedding gift. I'm trying to remember what her name is. I actually have the subject. So the icon was given as a wedding gift, and it was painted. In the late 11th or early 12th century. It was given as a wedding gift from Byzantium when one of the emperor's daughters married, for political reasons, one of the sons of a Russian prince. And that's where she gets the name, the mother of God, Vladimir. And so it was in the town of Vladimir that God chose to work miracles through this icon, and that's why she's known as the mother of God, Vladimir. It protected the city of Vladimir and many times from being invaded by Tartars, by Tamerlane and the Swedes. If you name someone who's trying to invade the country, she protected them. And that is why she is so beloved in Russia. She became the official icon of Russia, and that icon specifically, the original, is in the Tretiakov Gallery. Actually, it's no longer in the Tretiakov Gallery, but it's in the church that is on the So it is still now being created in front of it instead of just being in gallery. But what is very important about this icon, if you click for me, is the fact that the only remaining original painting from this icon is this part of Jesus' face, his hand, and this part of her face, and then this tiny little bit on his garment. That's the only original part that's left. The rest was lost in the fire, and so everything else that we saw, that is reconstruction. And so a few years ago, the Archimedes Zenon, who I mentioned, he was commissioned by the Moscow Patriarchy to paint what he felt the Vladimir Mother of God icon looked like without any of the reconstruction, what it would have looked like originally. And he did an absolutely amazing job. Still looks like Vladimir Mother of God, but there's slight differences in how Jesus is represented. But she really cleaned up very well. If you click on the next one, this is also a Vladimir Mother of God. But this one was painted by Andrei Rublev. And so you can tell the difference between the two of them. Go back to the previous one. Jesus has his hand around her neck. And so there is the hand here. And then you can see, if you drew a circle or a half circle, their lips form a half circle. And they're sweetly kissing. This is known, this category of icon is known as Eleusa, so tenderness or sweetly kissing. Go to the next icon. And so you can tell the difference. The hands are on the same level. Jesus doesn't have his armor on the back, and they're almost looking eye to eye. And so you can tell this one was painted by Andrei Rublev, and so you can see in the next photograph. Oh, sorry. There's something really lovely about this icon and very sensitive and tender about it. Next. And you can see this person who painted the icon, he used both of them. So he put the hand behind the neck. He painted Jesus not exactly mouth to mouth, but almost eye to eye. Really cheek to cheek. And so Mary's gained a bit of weight. But you see, the interesting thing about all of this your religion. So every church in Russia has the original flag and mother of God, because they have a flag and mother of God. It's amazing. So here in the Western world, we are so worried about originality. Is this the original one? Well, so what? If it is, or isn't. The opposite is true as well. So I've got in my iconography classes, I have one of my students who asks me regularly, well, what is the name of this icon? What is the name of this icon? And I was doing the same thing with my instructor, George Curtis. He's a lovely man, and I love him to bits. And I said, well, what is the name of this Theotokos icon you painted? And he said, well, it's the Mother of God and Jesus. Well, no, what is its name? What is its origin? It's the Mother of God and Jesus. And there was no model. He simply painted from his heart an icon of the Theotokos. I said, so there's no precedent. And he goes, well, someone had to paint the original icon. That is miracle working, and perhaps one day God will choose to work miracles through this icon. So it's the Mother of God and Jesus. For example, when I'm doing Jesus, my icon doesn't look like any other icon except for an icon of Jesus, because what I was taught in my classes in Finland is to gather several different